إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدًا عبد الله تعالى ورسوله، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تخونوا الله والرسول وتخونوا أماناتكم وأنتم تعلمون. وقال تعالى أيضا: وآخرون اعترفوا بذنوبهم خلفوا عملا صالحا وآخر سيئا عسى الله أن يتوب عليهم، إن الله غفور رحيم. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. To Allah we belong and to him we return. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his slave and messenger. First and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and all of you all seated here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa, that is to fear Allah the Almighty and be conscious of Him at all moments and at all times, can a slave of Allah achieve success in this world and the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. Inshallah, today's khutbah is going to be about a very profound statement of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. A very beautiful statement where he says, إِذَا غُرِسَتْ شَجَرَةُ الْمَحَبَّةِ إِذَا غُرِسَتْ شَجَرَةُ الْمَحَبَّةِ فِي الْقَلْبِ وَسُقِيَتْ بِمَاءِ الْإِخْلَاصِ وَمُتَابَعَةِ الْحَبِيبِ أَثْمَرَتْ أَنْوَاعَ الثِّمَارِ أصلها ثابت في قرار القلب وفرعها متصل بسدرة المنتهى. الله أكبر. Beautiful statement, a profound statement which we shall break into pieces and discuss inshallah ta'ala. So Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, the student of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says that if the tree of mahabba, if the tree of love, and what love is he talking about? The love for Allah, the Almighty, our powerful and beloved Maker, and likewise the love for His beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If that tree is planted in an individual's heart, qalb, an amazing creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is named as qalb because it twists and it turns. It is between the fingers of Ar-Rahman. He twists and turns it the way he wishes and the way he wills. If this tree is planted in an individual's heart, وَسُقِيَتْ بِمَاءِ الْإِخْلَاصِ وَمُتَابَعَةِ الْحَبِيبِ, and if that tree is watered, any tree, any plant, we have to water it. So this tree, we plant it in our hearts and we water it we nurture it بماء الإخلاص, with pure water, the water of إخلاص, the water of sincerity, and likewise متابعة الحبيب, and the following of our beloved master Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, adopting his life as our life. If we water this tree with إخلاص and متابعة الحبيب, he goes on to say that that tree will grow into such a beautiful tree. It will start giving fruits. It will start benefiting that slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because sadly, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, when we look at the world around today, ikhlas is something that is lacking in the Muslim ummah today. Today what has happened, deeds are done for show. Good deeds are done for show. Charity is given for a name, or for show, or for the people. This is something that has to be ingrained in every single amal of ours, however small it may be, or however great the amal may be. Whether it even be a tiny piece of date that we give in charity, we're not talking about millions here. Some people dish out millions to be known as a philanthropist, to be known as a person who is a great social worker, all for show and fame. But in reality, even a tiny piece of date, if we were to give it out, we should give it in such a manner that if the right hand is giving it out, the left hand should not know about it, solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are numerous anecdotes from our Salafuna Salih, from our beloved Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, that highlight the importance of ikhlas in our amal. Look at this beautiful incident that took place during the khilafah of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu, a great caliph, he had the habit of going around during the night checking on the situation or the conditions of his subjects. He used to go, not disguising himself, but not going with people around him so that he would be known as Amirul Mu'mineen. He would go just like an ordinary person. He would walk through the streets, checking on the people, checking on their condition, checking on the halat and the ahwal of his subjects. So one night, as he was passing through the outskirts of the city, he sees a tent pitched up far away. He walks to the tent. He sees a man seated outside the tent. He goes up to him and he finds it difficult to recognize this individual. So it is as if perhaps he's a traveler, he's a passerby. So he goes to him and asks him, Ya Rajul, what brings you here? Oh man, what brings you here? The man says, that's none of your business, move away, go. Now I told you, he does not go known as Amir al-Mu'mineen, he goes like an ordinary man. So Umar radiallahu anhu, he insists. He says, no, tell me, why have you come here and why have you pitched camp outside, in the sense in the outskirts of the city? Then the man says, I have come to meet Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar radiallahu anhu. Then Umar radiallahu anhu, he being the Amir al-Mu'mineen, he asks this man, have you ever seen Umar? Do you know who Umar is? Umar radiallahu anhu asked him. The man says, no, I have some needs to be addressed. I have some issues that I need to put forward to him. That's why I have come. Now, while they were in this conversation, Umar radiallahu anhu, he hears a groan from inside the tent. Then he asks the man, who is inside the tent? And why is that person groaning out of pain? It was the sound of a woman. The man once again says, that's none of your business. We have spoken enough. Please go. Umar radiallahu anhu insists, no, you tell me, what is it? What's going on? Then he says, we undertook a journey to meet Amir al-Mu'mineen, but now my wife is in labor and she is going through the labor pains. Umar radiallahu anhu, he shivers. Why? Because this is one of his subjects out in the middle of the night at the outskirts of Medina. A lady is going through labor pain. And he being the Khalifa, he used to take this role very seriously. He rushes back home. He rushes back home in the middle of the night. He wakes up his wife and he asks her, do you want to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do you want to be involved in a deed that would win the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And look at this beautiful bond between the husband and the wife. Today, if we were to go and wake our wives at the middle of the night and ask them to come out, we would hear something else from them. But she immediately wakes up. She immediately gets up and says, what should be done? He asked her to gather things that would help to give birth, in the sense to help that lady in her labor, and he prepares for some food and things like that. Husband and wife, Umar radiallahu anhu and his wife, they travel to the outskirts of the city and go towards the tent. And Umar radiallahu anhu tells the man, my wife will help your wife during her labor. His wife enters the camp, whilst Umar radiallahu anhu, by himself, all alone, he goes and gathers firewood, lights a fire, and begins to cook something similar to broth. He puts the water and the flour and the meat and starts cooking by himself. The man was seated on a chair or something, observing all of this. His wife is inside, Umar radiallahu anhu's wife is inside, helping that lady, that man's wife, in her labor. Now he finished cooking. The child is born. The child is born. Umar radiallahu anhu's wife calls out from inside the tent, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. She calls out, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Give glad tidings to your companion that a baby boy is born. Alhamdulillah. The man, the minute he heard the words Amir al-Mu'mineen, he literally fell off his chair. Allahu Akbar. He literally fell off his chair. He was shocked. Amir al-Mu'mineen, the Khalifa himself, his wife has come and helped my wife in her labor. And he is seated down on the ground cooking food for me. I can't believe it. This, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, was the level of sincerity in our Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. Every single amal they did it solely for the pleasure of Allah. They did not do it for fame, for name, for power, for authority. No. They did it solely to win the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at this instance of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu used to observe Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu every single morning. So during Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's khilafah, after Fajr Salah, after some time, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu used to head out somewhere. Now see, there was always a competition towards good between Umar radiallahu anhu and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Each one of them was trying, competing with one another in good deeds. So Umar radiallahu anhu used to notice Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu going out every single day. So he was curious. So one day, he follows Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to see where he is headed. And he finds out Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu going towards the outskirts of the city, entering a shabby tent, and after some time, perhaps an hour or two, he comes back and goes on his daily routine. So the next day, Umar radiallahu anhu, after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu went away, he goes into that tent. He finds an old lady seated. So he calls out, Assalamu alaikum, and she replies, Wa alaikum assalam. So then he asked her, O lady, do you know of the man who comes every single day to your tent? Why does he come? And then he realizes that lady, not only is she old, she's also blind. She's also blind. Then she says, who are you, my son? He says, no, I want to know in regard to that man. Why does he come to your tent? She says, Wallahi, I don't know. He is a good soul who comes every single day to my tent because I am a widow. I am a widow. There is no one to help me. I am blind. He comes every single day. He cleans my tent. He sweeps my tent. He cooks food for my children and leaves it aside. And he washes my clothes and he goes every single day. Khalifa, the leader of the believers, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Umar radiallahu anhu immediately says, Allahu Akbar, Ya Abu Bakr, oh Abu Bakr, you have indeed made the post of Khilafah difficult for the person who is going to come after you. Look at the concern. Look at the concern to go every single day with all of his chores, with all of his duties, to look after this old blind woman. And for whom, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? For none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the importance we need to be giving for ikhlas. Whatever we do, however many good deeds we do, whether it is coming to the masjid, whether it is praying in the first saf, whatever we do it solely for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not for show and not for the people. Now, mutaba'at al-habib, we move on to the next part of watering this tree, following our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the love that one has to ingrain within himself for our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name. It is part of iman. It is part of iman. What is the definition of iman? Iman, which we say belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, belief in the unseen. Iman is qawlun bil lisan. It is that we need to utter the kalima. We need to testify using our tongue, qawlun bil lisan. Wa tasdeequn bil jinan aw bil qalb. And it is not only sufficient for you to say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. No. You have to bring that belief firmly in your heart. Tasdeequn bil jinan. You need to testify. You need to confirm each and every single word you utter from the testimony of shahada. So qawlun bil lisan wa tasdeequn bil jinan aw bil qalb. And also, you need to al-amalu bil arkan. You can't say, I have said the kalima and I also believe that Allah is my, is the only person, is the only deity worthy of worship. Forgive me. The only deity worthy of worship, and likewise Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger, so I don't have to make salah, I don't have to do the other a'mal, I don't have to fast in Ramadan. No. Three things: qawlun bil lisan, uttering the testimony using by your tongue; tasdeequn bil jinan, confirming it with your heart; and amalun bil arkan, the a'mal has to start flowing through your limbs. This is the definition of iman. So what about imanun bil rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Now what am I trying to highlight here? In regard to iman of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the definition is that you say qawlun bil lisan in regard to his nubuwwah. We testify. The second part of the kalima, ashhadu anna Muhammadar Rasulullah. We testify that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's slave and messenger. We testify. Likewise, we need to indoctrinate the belief that he has come with the true message in regard to his risala. Ay, tasdeequn bi risalatihi. This is part of iman. And finally, amal bi mutaba'atihi. Whatever a'mal we do, we follow the teachings of our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. None of us can claim today, oh, I feel very spiritual today, so I'm going to make 4 rak'at of Jummah Salah. Will it be accepted? Will he get more good deeds? No. He has to follow the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If it is 2 rak'at, he has to make 2 rak'at. If it is 2 rak'at, he has to make 2 rak'at. If sawm is prescribed as such from dawn till maghrib, till sunset, then so be it, he has to fast accordingly. He cannot fast consecutively for 2 continuous days. Likewise, all of the a'mal, we follow the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is part of iman. And likewise, bringing in the love for our Habib Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need to love him. We need to love him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May myself, my father, my mother, my children, my wife, all of them be sacrificed and ransomed for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need to love him more than our wives, more than our wealth, more than our children. Why? Even more than ourselves. Allahu Akbar. This is the love that we need to bring in regard to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And just as I said that iman billah and iman bil rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes hand in hand, even the hubb of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hubb of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam go hand in hand. Look at the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم.
أو محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم tell them, إن كنتم تحبون الله, if you love Allah سبحانه وتعالى فاتبعوني. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, these are the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then follow me. Adopt my lifestyle as your lifestyle. Today, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we suffer complexes to look like our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are ashamed to portray his sunnah, to portray his life as our life. We are ashamed to adopt his life as our lives. Sadly, this is our situation. But if you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what would the results be? Yuhbibukumullah. Allah the Almighty in return would love you. Wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum. And forgive all of your sins. Wallahu ghafurur rahim. Indeed, Allah the Almighty is the most forgiving, most merciful. Umar radiallahu anhu, he once comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tells him, the hadith goes along the lines of these words. He tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, I love you more than anything in this world except for myself. I love you more than anything in this world except for myself. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no, Ya Umar radiallahu anhu, you have to love me, along the lines of these words, you have to love me more than even yourself. Allah. Umar radiallahu anhu immediately says, Ya Rasulullah, then I love you more than myself. A question could arise as to why did Umar radiallahu anhu immediately switch his statement. The reason being, scholars as Imam al-Khattabi rahimahullah, they mention that an individual loving himself, you and I, we love ourselves, we treasure our lives. This love is known as hubb al-taba. This is a natural love ingrained within ourselves. All of us, we love ourselves. None of us would jump out of the window. We all love ourselves. This is hubb al-taba. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not warn that hubb al-taba, but rather he was highlighting and showing Umar radiallahu anhu the importance of hub ikhtiyari. Hub ikhtiyari comes about when there are reasons. You love a person due to some reasons. Like for example, all of us love our parents because we know what our parents did to us. This is a hub ikhtiyari. We have chose to love them or those individuals, whoever they may be. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted Umar radiallahu anhu to know that if you choose me, O Umar, over yourself, that would be a reason for you to be saved from the fire of Jahannam. Allah Akbar. It is a hub ikhtiyari. If you choose me over yourself, you will be saved from the fire of Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill all our hearts with love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and likewise save us from the fire of Jahannam. Another hadith, Anas radiallahu anhu, he narrates Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ, he whose hand is my soul in, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده. None of y'all have truly brought in iman. That's what I said. The hub of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is closely linked with iman. None of y'all have truly believed until and unless you love me. لا يؤمن أحدكم. None of you have truly believed until all of y'all have loved me more than your own parents. وَوَلَدِهِ, more than your own children. وَالنَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ, more than any human being on the face of this earth. The love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the seal of the Prophet, the greatest of all prophets. This love has to be indoctrinated in our hearts, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So many incidents from the lives of the Sahaba, رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين, that highlight the love that they had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at the battle of Uhud. During the battle of Uhud, Abu Talha ibn Ubaidillah radiallahu anhu, it was a critical situation in that battle. The kuffar were pelting arrows after arrows at the Muslim army. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu, he rushes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he becomes a human shield. He becomes a human shield protecting Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He puts forward his body to protect Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The arrows start piercing him. At that moment, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tries to look from behind Abu Talha radiallahu anhu. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu cries out, "Ya Rasulullah! May my mother and father be sacrificed for you. Ya Rasulullah, don't look. I fear that one of those arrows might come and harm you. And I wish that my neck be harmed than you, Ya Rasulullah." This was the love that they had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he then rushes to protect Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was all during the battle of Uhud. And Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, another beautiful incident that took place. When he embraced Islam, his mother vowed that she would go under a fast, she would not consume any food or drink until and unless Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu come back, you know, leaves Islam. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, he kept quiet because he thought his mother did not mean what she said. But as time went on, she really stood up to what she said, and days were passing, she was not eating nor drinking. He kept on approaching her, "Oh my beloved mother, oh my beloved mother, please leave it, please leave this fast. You know I am upon haq, I am upon truth." But she was stubborn, she was determined not to leave the fast. Finally, after a few days passed by, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu goes to his mother and says, "Oh my beloved mother, oh my beloved mother, I love you. I love you as my mother, but know one thing, that my love for Allah and His Rasul, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is much, much more than the love I have for you. And let me tell you something. Even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to give you 1,000 lives, 1,000 lives, and if you were to fast like this and give up one life after the other and all 1,000 lives went like this, I would not leave Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." This was the love they had for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Another lady during the same battle of Uhud, she rushes, she comes running to the battlefield. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in inform her, "Oh lady, your husband has passed away in this battle. It doesn't matter, where is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Where is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam?" She goes a bit further. Another person informs her, "Your father has also passed away in this battle as a shaheed. It doesn't matter, where is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam?" She goes a bit further. Another person informs her, "Your brother has passed away in this battle. It doesn't matter, where is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam?" And her heart was at peace only when she set her eyes upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the love the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in had for our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today, we have individuals claiming that they love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have people crying out that they love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but it is only hot air on their tongues. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, there's no point in shouting out that you love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam if you don't adopt his life as your life. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ. Whatever he came with, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever he commanded us to do, we do. وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. And whatever he has prohibited us, we stay away. This is true love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. We adopt his life as our lives. We bring in his sunnahs into our lives. This is how we can prove that we really love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now coming back to the statement of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that if you water this tree with these two precious things, asmarat anwa asimar, this tree would bring about beautiful fruits. Asluha thabitun fi qarar al-qalb, and this tree would be thabit fi qarar al-qalb. It will be firm in an individual's heart. وَفَرْعُهَا مُتَّصِلٌ بِسِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى, and the branches of this beautiful tree would even reach Sidratul Muntaha. Allahu Akbar. This tree, the roots will be firmly in an individual's heart, whilst the branches would reach Sidratul Muntaha. Allahu Akbar. This is the beauty of this tree, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And finally, I leave you all with an advice, and that is in regard to never losing hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah the Almighty, the most forgiving, the most merciful, He's waiting for all of us to turn to Him sincerely. Allah the Almighty is willing to forgive all of our sins. We need to take the initiative and turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as how the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and just as how they never lost hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, two more minutes, I share with you all the story of a great Sahabi radiallahu anhu. His name was Abu Lubaba. His name was Abu Lubaba. The story is just to highlight that none of us should ever lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This was during the battle of Khandaq, the battle of the trenches. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had an agreement with a tribe, a Jewish tribe known as Banu Qurayza, that Medina would be protected in the sense by the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in digging trenches towards the front side of Medina. And the agreement with Banu Qurayza was that they would protect the city from behind. They would stay on guard from behind and protect the city from behind. This was an agreement between Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Banu Qurayza. Banu Qurayza, a Jewish tribe, they breached the agreement. They betrayed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and during the battle, they let in a few Kuffar slipped through the barracks of the Muslim army and attacked Medina from behind. So after the battle, what happened was, they knew that they had betrayed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so they took protection in a particular fortress. The Muslim army, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, besieged Banu Qurayza for almost about a month. They were trapped in this fortress with no food or water. So after the food and water ran out, whatever the provisions they had, they were up for negotiations now. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam calls Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, because he used to be a friend or a known ally of Banu Qurayza. He knew them well. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Abu Lubaba to talk on behalf of the Muslims. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed Abu Lubaba to tell them to come out from the fortress. Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, he goes to Banu Qurayza and he instructed them as to what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had advised him to do so. As he was instructing them, the women, all of them came running out because they're starving, no food, no water. They come up to him and they say, Ya Aba Lubaba, Ya Aba Lubaba. They start crying out, tell us, what is your advice? What should we do? What will happen if we come out? Now Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, at that moment, he did not utter anything, but he signaled something like this. He moved his hand across his throat, signifying it's going to be a massacre. If you come out, it is going to be a massacre. Now this action of Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, he did not utter anything, it was just an indication, an action. He moved his hand across his throat. It caused a lot of fitna amongst the Banu Qurayza. So the minute he came out from the fortress, and before I go on, scholars of Tafasir, they mentioned that this story was the reason of revelation behind this ayah. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu la takhunu allaha wal rasul wa takhunu amanatikum wa antum ta'lamun. O you who believe, لا تخون الله والرسول. Do not deceive Allah. Do not try to deceive Allah سبحانه وتعالى nor His messenger. And do not deceive those things that have been placed as a trust by you وأنتم تعلمون. Whilst you all are aware of it. So Abu Lubaba, he comes rushing out. رضي الله عنه, he comes rushing out and he goes straight to Masjid al-Nabawi. He goes straight to Masjid al-Nabawi, the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he felt guilty. He knew that he betrayed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is something wrong I have done. He rushes to the Masjid and he ties himself up on a pillar. He ties himself up on a pillar and he declares, until and unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives me and reveals an ayah in regard to me, I will not untie myself from the pillar. The news goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was waiting patiently until the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. Six nights pass. His wife used to come and untie him for the times of salawat. He used to make salah and go back and tie himself, waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree. This shows, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they did not need any intermediary to reach out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So none of us need any intermediary. Rather, we can approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. He is waiting for the ayah to come down. 6 nights pass. The next day, the 7th morning, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wakes up smiling. If I'm not mistaken, it was Umm Salama radiallahu anha with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time. She asked, Ya Rasulullah, what is that great news that has made you so happy, Ya Rasulullah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah the Almighty has revealed a verse in regard to Abu Lubaba. Allahu Akbar. Umm Salama radiallahu anha, Ya Rasulullah, can I go and give this good news to Abu Lubaba? Perhaps it was before the ayah of hijab had come down. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam approves. She goes and cries out, Ya Abu Lubaba, an ayah has come down in regard to you. And what is this ayah, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam? وَآخَرُونَ اَعْتَرَفُوا بِذُنُوبِهِمْ خَلَتُوا عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَآخَرَ سَيِّئًا عَسَى اللَّهُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ وآخرون اعترفوا بذنوبهم خلطوا عملا صالحا وآخر سيئا. And there are those who have acknowledged their sins. They have acknowledged their evil deeds. بذنوبهم خلطوا عملا صالحا وآخر سيئا. They mixed up a good deed with a bad deed. Just as how he had done during the incident of Banu Qurayza. They have mixed up a good deed with a bad deed. عَسَى اللَّهُ أَن يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Allah the Almighty, perhaps He will forgive them. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Indeed, Allah the Almighty is the most forgiving, the most merciful. Allahu Akbar. When this news was given to Abu Lubaba, Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu, he says, I will still not untie myself until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself comes and unties me with his blessed hands. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes to Salatul Fajr and he goes and unties Abu Lubaba radiallahu anhu. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this story is just to highlight that it is not up to us to despair in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not up to us to lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is waiting to forgive us. And even if we were to go to Him with mountains of sins, with sins that reach the heavens, Allah the Almighty is waiting with forgiveness to match that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So my advice to you is to never lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have faith in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and turn to Allah before it is too late. Turn to Allah before it is too late. Turn to Allah before the doors of tawbah are slammed shut. Turn to Him before it is too late and Allah will indeed forgive all of our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. And may He the Almighty accept all of our good deeds. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill our hearts with love for our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unite all of us in the gardens of Jannah. Wa akhir da'wayan. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.